welcome you to the presentation about GeneXus or create once and deploy everywhere. The meaning of create once and deploy everywhere is because this tool, GeneXus, that is a cross-platform development tool mainly oriented to enterprise class applications. The tool was created like around 20 years ago in a small country in South America called Uruguay. And from there, the tool was continually growing and improving in his ability to create and deploy software into different platforms. Okay, so we are creating software, or as we call it, this type of tool, code generators or compilers, and from there we are deploying that the code into different platforms like AS400 in the past, or nowadays in BlackBerry, iOS, Droid, and web servers. Okay, so we are doing, how we are doing that in a declarative mode, and you will see later on at the end of the class or the session how we can pretty easily generate code for the different platforms and deploy it in a very easy way. These are a couple of numbers that I extracted recently, and they are regarding of the usage of the different systems on smartphone devices. Okay, so we have that most of the smartphone devices are using Droid nowadays, in a 50% right now for USA, and in a 35% in the last stats indicator for Apple, okay, for iOS. That number grows and get a bit in favor of Google Droid if you move out the USA, okay? So we are attacking nowadays as developers or programmers or software engineers with a situation. We need to solve certain needs for our client or customers that represent or require that our application runs on different environments or can be attacking different environments. And how we can solve that situation of making a only one system, and that can system can be reused once over and over again, is by using this type of code generators like GeneXus. Okay, so this is the current technology stack that we are facing nowadays as a software engineers. We have a smart device spread around the air with different systems like Droid, iOS, BlackBerry, and Windows 8 coming soon. Also, we have different type of devices that can be accessing our systems, like telephone, tablets, and PCs. And there are also a widespread of way to consume that data or the system that we are providing to our customers or end users. Okay, the access to that data is coming through the cloud or in the really near past service or web apps, okay? And also at the same time we have different platforms that can generate those systems that we are consuming around there. Java, Ruby, .NET, and attached to that we have a problem of security that we need to address or to resolve for each one of the platforms that we are going to pick, and to prevent or to protect our system and therefore the data of our customers. So, in order to do that and to consolidate in only one spot all the needs at the moment of developing application for end customers in a medium to high level, this tool was evolved. And the latest version of the tool is called GeneXus Evolution 2. GeneXus Evolution 2 provides the main feature for attacking the current technology stack that we are facing today. Okay, the main one of these features is that we can create only one language that is called GeneXus, and we can deploy it to any of the platforms that I was mentioning before. Okay? So we are creating a code, an application, and that application can be reused to be deployed natively in a Android smartphone, on a iOS, iPhone, or iPad, or iPod, or in a BlackBerry even. And pretty soon, in 1 month, is coming the Windows Edge Generator also. I will explain later on which is the concept of the generator. The other thing that is attacking GeneXus Evolution 2 is the need to be complying with the standards. Okay, we are surrounded by standards around the HTML5, CSS, all that kind of things that we need to address in order to make our applications be complying with those standards. Okay, so the web applications generated by GeneXus are respecting the W3C standards by default. Okay, one of the other aspects that, because of the source or the origins of GeneXus, is the internationalization of the application. Nowadays, we can see it here in California that we need to, as software engineers or architects, we need to design our software taking into account that the population is really, in reality, asking us to deploy application or to offer them a solution that they can understand in their own language. Okay, so in a pretty easy way, GeneXus solved the situation of internationalization of the applications just by clicking on certain spot on the generator, and that enabled per default English, Chinese, Spanish, Portuguese into the applications. And the only thing that you need to do is to have sometimes a translator that can push the corresponding translation for the source code that is actually English. Okay. I will jump to the cloud. Why is so important the cloud? It's because we need to GeneXus address a problem pretty easily that sometimes I'm myself as a stream programming lover, the scene of create something and show that something that we are creating to address a need for our customer, show it immediately or show it as soon as possible to shorten the path of iteration that we need to go over with the customer to address their requirements or specific needs. So what we are doing with GeneXus on this version is deploying straight to the cloud. And which cloud? The Amazon cloud, and in the last months we are able to deploy to the Windows Azure cloud. Okay, so while you can come there with your spot for cloud deployment, you can come with GeneXus to help you pretty easy deploy and show whatever you are building for your end users. Okay, and then, well, the thing that I was explaining before, that we can build the usability of these applications, and it's going to widespread around the technology stack that I was pointing in the past page. So, safe, how GeneXus solve the problem of safety on our applications is by just clicking a checkbox into the generator, and selecting that checkbox is going to create the whole set of roles and user stakeholders for the application. So we don't need to care anymore about how the system is going to interact, or we need to create those ABM for users or so, and take into account how they are going to be consumed even for external applications to ours. So the GeneXus GAM, is GeneXus Access Manager, as it's called, is a module that allows our system to be protected in every sense of the word, because it's providing a background or security on in a defined set of pages that we can say, okay, I can I want to have this guy have admin privilege onto this web administration, and it's as easy as creating the user and assigning that role and forget about it. And that kind of single sign-on technology can be shared across the world with other platforms and can be reconsumed later on with other platforms using web service. So this is what I was explaining to you before about the details on to the previous graph. The idea that we are also providing domain semantics that I will explain in okay. The jumping into the development experience on how Synexus is addressing certain things to expedite the development ability and performance is adding these semantic domains. So whenever we are defining like a kind of data type of email address or geolocation, the system automatically on every and each page that is going to be reused later on is going to identify that we are working with a geolocation data type and add the corresponding linkage to Google Maps, or in the case of the iPad, with the corresponding mapping technology that they are using there. And the same thing is going to happen at the level of Android systems using the Google Maps embedded into our application that has been deployed natively onto the Android systems. Okay, so this is a sample of how the geolocation is embedded into an APM for a user, and the corresponding pin pointers are going to pop up the corresponding geo reference into a map. Then we are creating native application because it's what the market is requiring us to do today. With only set of lines code, we can create these applications and deploy it into even BlackBerry. And the difference is only going to be set by the one that is provided by the corresponding iOS. We don't need to make any magic around whatever Synexus is producing for the stack of AVMs or whatever, because the backend is handling the corresponding calls to REST services that are working on at the back end of our applications. And in the front end, we are using kind of templates for each one of those applications to show like a user interface accommodated to the needs of our client or the definition of our designers. So there are a couple of hardware features that are included per se on the smartphone application that we are developing. We are automatically, once we create these smartphones applications, we are embedding all the set of hardware features automatically on each application that we are creating with Synexus. So we don't need to jump and investigate what is needed to create a GPS association for our application in order to obtain the geolocation of a person. So it's automatically embedded into that native application, and therefore you can be reused just by a simple call of telling your application, hey, give me the location, the latitude and longitude for this guy. The same happens with the camera. You can only adding a data type of image onto your application's definitions is going to automatically embed that semantic into the application and will make pop up the camera at the level of the iPhone and your Android smartphone. Okay. At the same time, in a lower layer, let's call it, we have the association with the different applications and social media integration for our applications. We can automatically make calls to the scanner on the device. We can make tweets or connect with Facebook through our applications. And also, this is part of the GAM, the GeneXus Access Manager, that you can integrate the Twitter and Facebook authentication into your applications. And that will create, for that user that is connecting with that applications, a relation with the Twitter end. And therefore, you, whenever you make a tweet, the system will recognize that this is the account that belongs to that external system. Okay. Here are a couple of screenshots upon smart device applications that have been built into using GeneXus. This is one regarding consumption of alcohol. I don't think that this is a good example for this meeting, but anyways. This is one that shows specifically how you can create templates for the UI specifically for each iOS. I mean, here you can see the iOS end, and at the same time here for Droid, we have a way to show the data in a different way because it's for a different device. And that is automatically detected at the moment that we are creating the applications. We don't need to make any magic in order for the system to recognize which is that application, because natively it's going to integrate a template that was oriented for this type of device. Okay? So later on you can talk with your designers and they will define the behavior of the application on the user end, on the client's end, and make the corresponding modifications in order to make them more user friendly. Okay? And this is how GeneXus is doing that. I mean, every time that you define any iOS template, you're going to be using a given theme, or any Droid platform is going to be using a given theme, and that will apply at the moment that you are creating this this oriented device. Even you can define for a given Android tablet which is going to be the layout of the applications. Okay. And here are a couple of features that belong to the each one of the platforms per se, and that are being inherited or introduced in this latest version, and that can be automatically put in use by your applications at the moment of build. So we have push notifications using the GCM, the Google Cloud Messaging. They are automatically embedded into our applications. The only thing that we need is the GCM account or the server's APK to be used at the end of the smart device creation. And monetizing, this is how you can automatically embed in your applications the uses of ads or paid or even in-app purchases. And this is the thing that I was telling you guys before, that we can automatically create cross-platform notifications. We have only one source, and we can send notifications to any of the systems that have been attached to our centralized system. We can use Apple Push Notification Service for the iOS devices, or the Google Cloud Messaging from Google for the Droid devices. This is another of the future that GeneXus provide per se at the moment of creating flows for the for your systems. You can sit with your operation chief or someone from the company that you are working with and define with them which is the type of process for which you need to build a solution, and he can draw that solution itself. He can draw the process that is going to be followed by the system in order to provide a solution for a request. these are the type of results that can be drawn with these applications, with the GSflow. And this is how easy you can deploy to cloud. You with certain generators like Ruby, .NET, or Java, you simply say to the generator, okay, deploy to the cloud after the application is being created, and that will interconnect automatically with the source of your target, that in this case will be the Amazon cloud with a system running Ruby, and automatically will make all the necessary adjustments and upload the necessary information into the server. One of the important things of GeneXus is that it's a generator, it's a code generator that interacts automatically and dynamically with the DBMS. So you have like MySQL, PostgreSQL, SQL Server, DB2, and other databases around there that can be for which GeneXus can automatically create an application for the transactions that we need, the tables, inside them, and interconnect and maintain those transactions from within the environment of GeneXus. So GeneXus knows everything that is going on for the maintenance of the tables and the database schema from GeneXus itself. Okay? So that was the idea to make a showcase of this. Let's see if we can run. This is the GeneXus IDE, and as you can see, it's kind of similar to Visual Studio. And what you are doing here is, for instance, define the target environment. In this case, I defined the target environment for the code generator is going to be .NET. Okay, so you have a default code generator for .NET that is C#. And then I'm also adding that my intention is to create not also a web application from this end, but as well to create a smart device application. Okay? So at the moment that I'm adding this smart device generator, the environment will know from that moment that he needs to create all the necessary information for creating the target, like it's shown here, the target device. Okay, I here define that the main platform is Android because it's the easiest one to, in this case from Windows, to run the emulator and just test and prototype the applications from within the Windows environment. I can also generate iOS, I can generate BlackBerry, and as I was saying before, pretty soon you can automatically generate, you will be able also to automatically generate for Windows 8. Okay? A couple of definitions for the generator, that's not important. And at the level of the deployer, when, let me show you. Okay, so when I told the system that I will deploy to the cloud, automatically GeneXus embedded the information for where is located my deploy target, and that's it, end of the story. So I will show you pretty quick. The intention to be a small CRM to just showcase what can be done with this. So GeneXus, in the moment of creating all the necessary targets for the application, at the same time is creating the work with This is a pattern, a design pattern, like the one that we know from C# or that we can apply in Java. And also, when creating this object that will maintain or give the LVM ability, we don't need to do anything regarding this. GeneXus is going to take care of this piece. So I'm going to. And then the other thing that you can that we have here or provide here is for those generators or those smartphones or smart devices target is the QR code to download the application into your device. Okay, so automatically GeneXus will create the QR code for you to test the application and therefore play around with it and show it to your end users or the ones that are going to validate your application pretty soon. Or even later on to give access to the market. Okay? So this something here. When I begin, I define this transaction that will create a table onto the database with this schema structure. Okay, company ID, company name, and I don't need to do anything else later on after I apply the word with pattern that is showing here. Okay, so let's pretty quick create that transaction for a client. Okay, we have customer ID, and I will define that the type of this customer ID is numeric and is an auto number. Okay, and I will define that the customer name is a bar chart something. Okay, and I will need a customer email, and I will give this the semantic of email, and I will have also a customer address, and I will give that customer address a semantic of address. Let's one more customer geo and give that. So this is the definition for our table that will translate automatically into our schema in the database for customer table, a customer transaction. I will go and impact these changes into our database schema. So GeneXus detects that there is a new table, okay, and it's making something that is called a reorganization. Reorganization means that GeneXus, by the definition that he previously know of our database schema, he will apply these changes into the database. Okay, so we can also see which is the type of a statement that is going to be run by GeneXus in order to create that table. So GeneXus running the reorganization, you can see here on the stack which is the progress of that action of reorganizing or adding actually this transaction into the system. And later on, after he finished, is already applying changes onto the application related to that schema, and therefore uploading again, in this case, the application to the server. But because I didn't add any pattern to that customer transaction that you can see it here at the top, the system didn't do anything, just create the transaction and let me start inserting records there on the database. But what we are going to do is actually apply the pattern, the design pattern of WordWith, that is not other thing that tell GeneXus, please GeneXus create for me all the necessary APM for this table. And GeneXus will apply all the necessary changes onto that transaction, extract all the information that he needs, even the reference integrity with other tables, and create the necessary web panels or pages that needs to be created in order to maintain that customer. Okay, so now we are going to apply those changes. I'm just telling Genexus to apply those changes to apply in that design pattern. Notice that so far I didn't do not coding in the application. Genexus already built for me the work with customer from which I can go and just start creating a customer. So and let's say okay. And also because the application detects for image, for semantics that it was a geolocation, the customer geo, it embedded the localizator and tried to grab that information from the browser. But this version doesn't support it. So anyways, we are going to save this information and now we have our customer there. Okay, if I'm going to that customer, go here. Okay, if I'm going to edit that information, and all of this has been generated by Genexus, if I'm going to edit that email account, see that automatically, because it's the semantics of the domain that was defined, I can click over it and automatically link it with the email client. Okay, so we didn't have to do anything. And also, if you notice, there is a link over customer address that I can click and automatically will drop this into the Google Maps, because it's jumping or linking due to the semantics on the domain and the definition of the data type of the attribute, that he can reuse that information to jump to Google Maps and try to grab the corresponding address reference there in the map. Okay. So now what about the because we didn't see so far how we create the smart device end. I came here again and I apply a pattern that is called the word wheel for smart devices. Only one click again, and as soon as you apply that word wheel pattern, you can reference that pattern into a dashboard. That is the way that you can add reference to any work, any device, a smart device object created in the system. So I'm going here, picking work with the device customer. Adding here customer. Okay. And I will set up this test CRM as the startup option for the application. So far we didn't do anything, any other thing than being clicking, selecting checkbox, and automatically the AVMs and the core of the basement of the application has been created. Now it's giving an error, but I will prevent this type of things to happen. And I have on this other machine that can connect to the projector the sample application. Later on I will show it to you. So basically what is basically what we went through is to just define a set of rules for the applications, and later on the core of the application can be navigated or can easily be created, like using select for the database to load grids and show that information onto that grid in a very easy way. Okay? It was only a couple of clicks before I have my own application running there and with a pretty easy way to define it and navigate through my data. Okay? As I was saying to you, so I don't know if all are going to see here, but I'm running the emulator, and in the emulator I give access to the same functionality that we were having on the CRM, and that CRM application, if we click it onto the company information, it's going to load all the whole set or the stack of that data for that set of company that we loaded previously here, for example. And I can apply the same set of filters, like a common application, and nothing needs to be done. It's only GeneXus that was creating this for us. Okay? At the end of the road, you will need to start interacting, like we have different customers nowadays that for which we are providing like geolocations applications for a smart device in order to provide tracking and inventory management. And those types of applications has a set of line of code that we need to write behind the scene, and that became REST services that can be consumed even for your other platforms and can be reused across the world. Okay? Oh, one more thing. You can edit the information. And again, the semantic, you can see if you are far away, but the thing is the semantic begins at the level of the cell phones in that the geolocation, whenever it is detected, it's calling the corresponding service of location, or the phone is calling the telephone caller, the phone caller on the device. So far, any questions? Do you have the chance before to hear about GeneXus or? Okay. There is a showcase of GeneXus application built right now that you can go and review or showcase.genexus.com. There you can navigate and see what else can be done for this application. Usually, this tool has been used. GeneXus has been used in the latest 10 years for banking in South America. All the big banks in South America have been using GeneXus for maintaining their core main systems and ATMs, basically. And right now, it's also being used widely spread there in Brazil and South America by companies that are bigger consumers of supermarkets and so. Here in USA, the experience that we have is migrating systems from legacy Clipper DOS applications into web end and providing the ability to the companies to jump from a 10 years ago system environment to our CentOS environment. they are providing them the ability to expose themselves through smartphones now, and giving the capability to their end users to consume the data pretty easily, feeling the same way, whichever they jump from iOS, Android, or WebM. So, I think I'm pretty done with this one. If you want to contact or know anything more about this tool or the company or the type of consultant services that we provide, give me, drop me an email there, or we can find ourselves in Twitter through Gabriel Premajo. That's it. Nice to meet you guys.
Pricing
of the tool?
Yeah.
No, we don't talk about pricing. But the license for the tool is 5,000 baht per year.
This is what?
5,000 baht the first time that you buy the license.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you need to pay a maintenance fee of 150 baht per year. And that's it.
What was the offer amount?
$5,000.
For $5,000?
Yeah.
Upfront.
One time.
Okay.
And later on, you need to start paying the maintenance fee for the maintenance. It's for support.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah.
And then you have the other type of services that we are providing is developing the applications using the tool. You don't need to pay anything. The only thing that you need to pay is the service that we provide as a software development company. The idea is that it lowered by greatness in comparison with other type of platforms, because we don't need to, the maintenance fees are really cheap, and the productivity is increased using GeneXus like 8 times in comparison with other platforms. Like for instance, we have been making comparisons with .NET groups of 20 persons. Only one GeneXus developer can do the same job that they do in the same solution,
right,
in less amount of time. Yeah. So, and that's the alternative is to, as we explain all the time, we provide a sham for them to have the ability to pretty easily access their clients in nowadays technology, but at the same time we left open because GeneXus can adapt to any type of technology and can consume any source of data. I mean, it's DBMS open, so the really ability of GeneXus is lacks on the end of having the chance to provide performance, productivity, less cost in comparison with other platforms. Did you hear about GeneXus before?
No.
Yeah, usually here in the...
Yeah.
That is one of the reasons why we have been working. I have been working here in USA for the last 8 years, 9 years, and we have been using this for bigger companies, USAID, they are in the East Coast, in the federal government, also here on this end, we have been working with a lot of e-commerce solutions. We are trying to keep up pace there, but we also provide the same services to medium to short companies.
Thank you.
No, thanks to you guys.
So if you write those apps, do you have to use this environment, or do you write it in Objective-C and iOS and then you integrate it with your...
you write it on this environment.
Oh, okay.
All on this environment. Yeah,
okay.
You don't need to know even a line of Objective-C or Java.
And it generates the code for them.
Exactly. And you can even see the code.
Well,
you
can go. What about the UI and all the UI elements and everything? And you didn't even show that. So that's
sorry guys. And let's pretty quick see how you can interact with the UI. So, see, but what I only need to do here for obtaining the same layout. Let me see. Remember the my bar that has a grid on the side. Okay, the only thing that I have to do is to drop the name of the drink onto this grid.
Right. Okay. What about UI? Graphics and everything. Where do you
you can put it there. But you can here just say insert.
iOS and Android, they have different UI patterns that.
They accommodate automatically, but also remember that I was talking about the themes.
Mm-hmm.
So each theme that is going to be applied to the iOS device. Is going to be applying per se for that device, so he knows already. He inherited already the intelligence to grab that information and apply there. The only thing that you need to take into account in the moment of deploying this onto the Apple market is that you will need to count with the definition that they require, that is the size of the certain image and so on, to publish it. But also, that is something that you need to do in Titanium and Accelerator.
Okay, yeah.
So, so I can drop an image here by selecting it. I can import an image, or I can set it's a new external image coming from a source on the web, and that will do it. But let's say we are going to put something here like that cross. And that's it. You add it there, and at the moment of creating the APK, for instance, it's going to include that into the APK, and you forget about it. And the other thing is that, you remember, on the level of customization, you have the set of, like, this theme that is a simple Android, in where I can say, okay, the color for the grid that you are going to show is...
Okay, so you have different themes and you just change the...
Yeah, and you added yours, you can play around that and do... Your designer can play around with this and so on.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
And the other thing is, as I was telling you before, for each one of these SDE platforms, I can pick... I can say, okay, okay, see, I can create my own template for the tablet 7 inches and say, okay, let's use the simple Android 7 inches theme, and that is the one that is going to be applied in the moment of drawing and by recognition onto that tablet. And remember that also is going to be running natively onto the tablet, so it's an advantage.
Right. What about like code signing and there's like an element of code signing for iOS to sign the application with all those certificates that you get from Apple and stuff like that. Is that done automatically?
Is that done automatically? Yes. Okay. So you have that is already embedded there in the generation. So. Because remember I was telling you about the GSCM, the Google Cloud Messaging?
Mm-hmm.
Also there, you are using your server's API keys to make the Google Messaging work. Well, you you embedded them in here, and
right.
then that is supported.
But that's just for Android, and then push notifications for iOS.
For that, easy, particular for them.
Okay.
You need to go and create your PCK 12, whatever, and connect with them. Just push it there, and once it's back, you assign it to
okay.
the generator.
Yeah.
The other good things of this tool, I mean, not in comparison, I mean, everyone is providing it today. You have some sort of team foundation that allow you to work with your team, wherever they are. So there is another tool that is called the GeneXus Server that allow you to share and make the check-in and check-out of your code, and therefore keeps the change management on that code protected and into the different end, no? And you can have all your programmers working around there without the hesitation of making an overwrite or doing any bad stuff onto your code. And also you have integration with wikis. Here in documentation you can add the whole design of your application, and later on, just connecting with a wiki, you upload it dynamically into that wiki.
Let me show you, there is one object that is interesting. To know.
So, here, because I don't have any relation, but I can draw all the transactions here that are maintained through GeneXus, and I can see their inheritance, their foreign keys, their relation with other tables, and I can start working with my DBA onto those definitions and see which are the corrections, and therefore making improvements onto the application. And this type of object that is called a diagram is going to flow also at the level of the wiki, and therefore will be accessible for the upper management to decide whatever the path that you are following is the best one.